hard to gauge in this congregation because a lot of people show up at the last second. But I think we're going to go ahead and get started. I think we should. It seems like the right thing. Silence is killing me. So, welcome to our outdoor almost service. Been a really hard to figure out what to do with a service like this because it's been dry for like 2 months. And the one Sunday that we decided to do an outdoor service, it pours rain. So I think we're just enjoying that. So you notice somebody asked, where's the bulletins? Everybody kind of grabbed their, this is the music. But I really wanted to get you away from that today. That's really what I wanted you to kind of feel free from watching instead of participating. And so that's why we don't have a bulletin. Trust me, it'll all go. I'm not saying it goes smoothly, but it'll all go. So that's a good thing. So welcome to our service. We do have songbooks, and we're so thankful we have a group of players and singers who are going to lead us. Notice I said lead, not necessarily sing for us. So I'm encouraging you to join in the worship today. And I'm going to wait because now I've got John coming and a few other people. So we want to make sure we give them ample time to sit down.
Are you putting them right here?
This is what happens when you're late. You get called out.
Well, no. Oh. they're must be going to take their stuff downstairs. So we're going to start. Our opening song is, I Will Call Upon the Lord. I hope you can feel good about that. How many of you are willing to stand? Okay, good. Let's stand. Let's sing it on our feet.
So I'm just going to say quick that a couple of the songs that we picked this week are a little more campy oriented. I don't know if you saw in your newsletter that the church has been very generous to the four people who are going to camp.
Yep.
And Jude is one of them. We're very excited for her.
I can't hear you.
Oh, sorry. But so we're just going to do a few campy songs because it's summer and it's summer. It's Bible camp season.
So we need an echo.
We join in confession. I've got a number of pieces here, so I've got to kind of work through that. Oh. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails and whose promise is sure. So let us confess our sins in the presence of God and also in front of our neighbors. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned. We have hurt our community. We have squandered your blessings. We have hoarded our bounty. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Let us claim the gift of God's mercy, for we are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Teach us, good Lord God, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for reward, to accept that of knowing that we do your will through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to read from up here and hopefully you can all hear me. The reading for today is from the book of Romans, chapter 6, beginning with the first verse. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we, who died to sin, go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to rise for the gospel reading.
The gospel for today is found in Matthew chapter 10, beginning with the 24th verse. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground, unperceived by your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. Here ends the gospel.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. I don't know, but I know I've got a couple kids here. If you kids want to come forward, love to have a chance to have a kids' time message with you today. Perfect. Got a couple of you. Good. Yes. Oh, yeah. But before we do that, we're going to have another song. But you guys can come on up and we'll do the song together. What is the song?
It's Open the Eyes of My Heart.
Open the Eyes. If you guys want to sit up here, we'll sing it. You can sing it right next to me here. Can I have you? Okay. Well, she can wait if she wants to wait for a little bit, too. Thank you. I got a hug, too. Perfect. Played a game like Seek and Find, where I will release you on this area here, and we're looking for something, and I'm just going to tell you whether, I used to do hot and cold, but what I'm going to do now is going to do rainy or sunny. Sunny is you're getting closer, rainy is you're not getting close. No, that's the thing. You won't know. I'm just gonna let you know and get close to it. Okay. So if you guys want to just go find your place, a spot in there, and I'll start. We'll start the game. Okay. Okay. Here we go. So pretty rainy back there. A little bit less rainy here. A little bit. Okay. So good, guys. So still a little bit rainy. I mean, it's not raining cats and dogs, but. It's still raining here, and it's getting a little bit sunnier here, and I think somebody already has picked up on where this item might be, so that's still, it's not foggy, I mean, it's not quite rainy, it's still a bit foggy, but this is getting pretty warm right over here. In fact, it's getting really, really sunny, hot, sunshine. Totally, totally hot. Okay, so there you found it. Now, what you say? Yeah, I know. Scott did too. I said, man, I should have hit them a little better. But anyway, I've got three of them, so I'll give each of you one. I only have two with me right here. But just before you go, then, just the idea of, have you ever lost something before?
Yeah.
Yeah. So
I lost lots of things. You lost lots of things.
Yeah. I like that. A man after my own heart there. So, what do you do when you lose something? How do you go about finding it?
Ask
Mom. Again, my wife is back there. She knows very well. What was your statement, honey? What is it? Men look, but women find. Yeah. Men look, but women find. Yeah. You can. I'll tell you what. I think I'm going to ask your sister to be a really big older sister. I've got one in my room. Will you give that to her? And I promise to give you yours. So here's the thing is that sometimes we do lose things, and sometimes we look for someone to help us to find things. And so what happens when you do find something? How does that feel when you find something?
What are these?
They're peeps. Okay, they're marshmallows. They're really good marshmallows. Piece of chocolate, some graham crackers, you're on board, buddy. So the important thing is when we find things, we celebrate, right? We're happy because we found something. I like that image. We're going to talk a little bit about seeking. We're going to talk about finding. Also talk about losing things. What does it mean to lose something? Okay? Well, thank you. Oh, she brought the graham crackers with her already. What a girl. She's thinking far ahead. Chocolate, Dad? No?
Not for them.
Okay. You guys can go back to your places. Thank you very much for being here this morning. Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
You know, I don't necessarily, I'm not disappointed by this setting. It makes things really intimate. And that's kind of good. John, you feeling okay?
Oh, yeah.
Normally, John's got a nice place over there, kind of far from me. But I always got an eye for John, too. So good morning. May the grace and peace of Christ be with us in our hearts and our minds to give us hope. Amen. So the text is this. Those who find their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake will find it. Now, there's something kind of upsetting about those words, isn't there? Really, when you think about it? Jesus is warning his disciples that he might just as well be sitting here, too, because he's warning us today in this service, that opposition to his message and to our ministry is something we can count on. It's going to happen. It's not a matter of if. It's just a matter of when or where. And that is something that we also are aware of, and so we prepare for it. So how are we prepared for people who are in conflict with us? That's not an easy thing. No one likes conflict. Everyone likes smooth sailing. I was out on Wednesday watching the sailboats out there, and it's amazing what they do. There was probably 40, maybe 50 sailboats out this past Wednesday. But I've seen other days, Wednesdays, when the water's choppy. Maybe one boat out there, and that person probably has been doing a lot of sailing because no one likes it when the waters get choppy. Do you think that I have come to bring peace to the earth, Jesus asks. I'm not sure that we have sat down and truly thought that one out. I think I have always held peace as one of the products of being a follower of Christ. I've always contented myself with the idea that as a follower of Christ, peace is something that is mine to claim. It's probably not true to characterize the gospel as a word whose intent is to incite war or discord. It is by pure observation, though, that we realize that what Jesus is saying has something that cuts deeply into the core of who we are and who we believe Jesus to be. There is oftentimes little room for compromise, and that is in itself a place that creates conflict. It may not be Jesus' desire to create conflict, but loyalty to him moves us to hold firm often to our beliefs. Now, let's back up then for just a minute.
Because this whole text does not exist in a vacuum. The early church was caught between two very strong forces. There was the Roman Empire, with its strict rules about being loyal to the emperor, and there was also a strong Jewish community that believed in following Yahweh, this God of their ancestors, this God who brought them out of Egypt, who promised to give them a land and also to make them a great nation. A God who would send Messiah to free them and to oppose all of their enemies. Jesus just didn't seem to fulfill their idea of who a Messiah should be. So they're in this crucible of forces happening around them, and conflict immediately erupts. So there's the context. But the real story is that when these disciples became convinced that Jesus could possibly be God's chosen one, they were going to be at odds with just about everybody else. These conflicts would divide them and separate them. Only the lines of contention would not be limited to the loyalty of empire or just to those loyal to the Jewish tradition. Jesus means and warns that this belief would divide them at every level, even between family members. Now, I was reading the text and I noticed that, you know, it's fathers and sons, mothers-in-laws and daughters-in-law. The one thing that was missing, there was something missing there, and it doesn't say husbands and wives. And I kept wondering why that omission is made. Why not add that? And the only reason, the thing I could come up with is that in other parts of the Gospels, and certainly in the epistles, the alignment between Christ and his bride is something that's given as kind of this example of God's love for us. And so maybe that omission is done on purpose. I don't know. I'm just throwing that out as an idea, concept that I was working with. But remember this. In Jesus' times, family was everything. Everything. It was the line between life and death. It was your family that took care of you. It was your family that set you up. It was your family that made sure that you had food and clothing and land and everything. Without family, nobody survived. Family was important. Now we, don't we, know what it feels like to be maligned by the world? I love that word maligned. Not sure exactly what it means, but it sounds like that contention, that constant force battling against us. Now, Beelzebul is just another name for evil or the devil or whatever, the evil one. Hey, the roaring lion, as the scriptures say, Satan is roaring all over the world, over our communities, and even closer in our relationships, in our families, in our homes. And oftentimes we talk about our church as a family, and the evil one sometimes roars here as well. Churches too can be maligned by evil spirits. So where is the gospel for us today in this text? We need to look, we need to search in order to find it. So let me tell you a story. Joan and I had decided that we needed her insurance. It's class was changing, so we needed to go and not be a part of Social Security, Medicare. We needed to go down to the Social Security office in order to make that happen. It's a different kind of insurance. Don't complicated stuff. I have no idea. She takes care of all that. She helps me find all that, my way through that stuff. But we'd gone downtown on Friday. It was, we got down to Superior Street, realizing that Superior Street was closed. This is past Friday. So you know what was taking place down there. So it turns out that there was a man on top of a wall, and he was waving his arms and threatening to jump. And We went to our appointment, and as we were leaving, we got in our car and drove up a street kind of to the side of that, and I stopped. There's a stop sign, so I stopped. And there was this person, and he was waving his arms on the wall, and there was someone else who I'm assuming was trying to talk him down from that wall. I heard the next day that he had jumped to his death. I knew nothing about this man. I know nothing about his life. But I could feel the pain. Even from my car, I could feel his pain. We didn't stay. I didn't want to watch that. And I wish nobody else was watching it too, because I feel that sometimes it feels like that just contributes to the problem. But I kept wondering if his jumping was his search to find life in a place, in a time that was denying him life. Is it possible to think that in losing his life, he was actually finding it? Now, it seems to me that there's got to be a better way. Don't you? Doesn't there have to be a better way? Maybe that's why Matthew records those words. So have no fear of them, those who can take the body. There's a better way. There's something beyond what we're experiencing, this maligned life that we live and exist in. This life Beelzebub plans for us. Don't worry. Satan will be found out. Fate will be unmasked. This life, as good as it is not everything there is. Do not fear. For God loves you. Even more than two sparrows which are sold for pennies. Listen, God has not even withheld his own son to redeem you. Even the hairs of your head are all counted. Now, for a middle-aged, okay, older man, this example does not fit neatly. But the point does. Losing your life to Christ is the life-giving discovery of your life. There is good news. There is great love. There is no greater love than this. My pain is not knowing how best to share that message to the world. And I bet you're wondering the same thing. We hear that message here, but how do we share it to the people on the walls? To the people who find themselves absolutely desolate and alone. To the people on the walls, maybe the story of grace is one that we dare not be silent about. Gospel stories. Here's one for you. So, yes, there's that experience. And then there's this one. Joan and I had gone to see our granddaughter play a soccer game 8 o'clock yesterday morning. We got there late. Don't ask why. But on our way back, we stopped at the Rhubarb Festival. Anybody go to the Rhubarb Festival? Wow! Man! Good stuff! A lot of wall walkers down at the festival. And yet, there was a man singing there, and I wish I had the knowledge to put it up on this monitor, to hear this guy, full beard. I mean, I have no idea where he lays his head, but I would be wondering. but singing about a community that's reaching out, a community that we, the song, what was the song again? This land is your land, this land is my land? Wow, from California to the Great Lakes, and talking about this land is made for you and me. This is a gospel that's made for you and me and everyone else, even those who are climbing the walls. This is the good news. This is the good news for us. New life in Christ. I can count on Jesus to help me find that. Peace be with you. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
It says we have another song.
That's accurate.
Very good. Intercession is that I will basically say, God in your mercy, and the response is, hear our prayers. Let's just try that. God of mercy,
hear our prayers.
Trusting God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. You entice your church to speak truth that challenges false notions of peace. Prevail upon us with the good news of Christ's death and resurrection, that we are compelled to share the gospel with all the world. God, in your mercy,
Amen.
Under your watch, not even a sparrow goes unnoticed. safeguard plant and animal habitats threatened by melting glaciers, rising oceans, and receding coastlines. Amplify the voices of those calling for responsible stewardship of the Earth's resources. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Our world is enduring violence and destruction. Rescue your people and nations experiencing conflict or crisis. Thwart the efforts of those who sow chaos and terror, and guide those working to bring about peace and reconciliation. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have counted even the hairs of our heads. Reassure everyone experiencing poverty, homelessness, unemployment, or exploitation that every life has value. Look favor upon all who struggle. I think especially of those who have been marginalized, even in our own neighborhoods. We ask that you watch over those working with CHUM. We ask that you would also watch over our kids getting ready for camp, that they may learn about the goodness of your grace. Be with those experiencing difficult times. Be with Stan Hammer's family today. Watch over Julian Raymond's family today. Answer us, for your steadfast love is good. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Even when we experience rejection, your love invites us to new life. Lift up everyone and anyone who feels shunned and excluded or counted for their gender, race, sexual orientation, gender identity, national origin, or any other human distinction. Make your people one. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All who have died in Christ also live with him. We give thanks for all the saints whose faithful confession inspired our own discipleship and raised us with them to eternal life. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. And the people said, Amen. At this time, I invite you to rise, get ready to mingle. It is the time to share the peace. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share the peace with each other this morning. So, along with the peace, becomes a way of sharing our peace with the world as well. Our offerings are those kinds of places, go to those kinds of places. So we receive our offering this morning. Thank you for your generosity. Prayer of thanksgiving for these gifts this morning. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation. Multiply your generosity and your graciousness through us and in us, that the world may be fed with your love, through Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." United in Christ, let us pray together the prayer that he taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated. For those who want to receive the official cups, I don't know if everybody saw that. You're welcome to come up if you didn't get one at this time as I call people forward. I'm not sure exactly how the ushers want to do this. We'll release people in pews. Remember that someone cannot get to where they were when they go back, so you might have to kind of let people go by in order to make that work. Our meal is provided by Christ himself today. He is our host, and he invites us to come and be a part of his family in this meal. You are welcomed, no matter who you are or where you come from. And so we invite you to come forward at this time. It is by intinction this morning, so just ask you to place your hand out, and then the chalice has both grape juice and wine in it. The grape juice is the more clear, the wine is the darker red. Come now, for all has been made ready for us. I think there are songs.
There's a song. Do you need me to move?
No, somebody come up. Somebody come up.
Thank you. Pray. Gracious God, thank you for this meal. Thank you for inviting us here today to be with each other. May the conflicts we experience be conflicts that only draw us closer to you, to remember that you see us as valuable, as you see all of your children and all of your creation as valuable. Bless us as we leave this place today. Sustain us with this food, this body and blood that you have spilled and given to us, and help us to know that you go with us no matter where we go. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
I don't have a blessing written down, so this is off the top of my head. May the blessings of Christ watch over you this week. Take him with you, wherever you find yourself, and know that in finding him, you have found who you are. Amen. So we have a ascending song, and then a prayer for a potluck. You know what the song is, but prayer for a potluck song. Oh, we need to stand? Is it the standing song? It's the standing song.
Fire in my soul, and the flame to make me grow. So there's no doubt.
theology is about the only thing I can think of for a...
Hey.
It's your dad or what was the other... There's a couple other good...
There's some great... Yeah.
Can you think of one?
Johnny Appleseed.
Oh, those guys know Johnny Appleseed?
It's already raining, so... Well, at camp they say if you do Johnny Appleseed, it'll make it rain. But it's already raining, so it doesn't matter.
Okay, so we'll do Johnny Appleseed. If you know it, sing along.
Do we have to do it twice or...
Singular? Just once. Here we go. Oh, the Lord is good to me, and so I thank the Lord for giving me the things I need, the sun and the rain and the apple seed. The Lord is good to me. Amen, 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 amen.
Oh, it's like we practice.
Please don't leave. Come downstairs, enjoy some time together. There's plenty of food and good, great conversation fellowship. So please, let's go downstairs and enjoy.
Okay.